So to start our concert today with a traditional German posthorn, that's what this little guy is. And no, the mail won't be coming because it's Sunday. But welcome everyone to the North Oakland Concert Band's new season for the 2015-2016 season. We're great that you're here today. We have a great concert for you. First, I do want to say thank you very much to Sharon and George Sinnott for sponsoring today's concert with their generous donation. Let's give them a big round of applause. Okay, Drew, you can take it up if you like. So before we get started, everyone, please switch off your cell phones, band members, YouTube. Mine's off. And I just wanted to point out that there were programs. If you, hopefully you got a program on your way in. The restrooms are out to the right and around the corner. We will be having an intermission. First, the North Oakland Concert Band will start. And then we are pleased today to have from a traditional, very excellent German band called Ein Frozen. So let's get started. I believe Tracy's going to introduce the first piece.
Ja, guten Tag. Ja, darf ich mal fragen, wie viele von Ihnen sind eigentlich in Deutschland geboren? Und auch Deutsch können, ja? Good. Well, we're very happy to have you here this afternoon. We're going to start with a piece called Alphorn Swing, and we play it because we just want to be able to at least represent that we can swing as well as anybody else. The little posthorn that you saw that Mark had is pretty much the same idea as an alphorn or a bugle. They're brass instruments, even though these are completely wooden. And they're brass because the sound is made by the vibration of your lips. Can somebody give us a few sample notes on an alphorn?
That's really all I'm playing. That's what I play.
That's the jet fighter sound. Screech Alphorn, everybody. So, without further ado, here we have Alphorn Swing.
Thank you.
That it is played every year along with the Blue Danube in the Vienna Philharmonic's New Year's Day concert. The programmatic scoring evokes elemental weather events through the extensive use of timpani and the clashing of cymbals suggesting gusts of wind and thunder. Without further ado, the Thunder and Lightning March by Strauss.
we moved from the very light, fizzy music of Johann Strauss's Donner Blitz Polka, or Thunder and Lightning, to somewhat heavier fare. How many of you are familiar with Richard Wagner? And of those people, how many of your knowledge comes from watching Bugs Bunny when you were kids? All of you! Okay, great. We have for you the famous, often heard, and very challenging Ride of the Valkyries. This is a famous section of the Ring of the Nibelungen, a quartet of operas by Richard Wagner. And the Valkyries were superhuman, mythical, very strong women who had strong attachments to their horses, but also very, very strong voices and memorable appearances in the Wagner operas. Has anybody here, of you Wagnerites, anybody actually seen a Valkyrie? Ah, where'd you see a Valkyrie? Where'd you see one?
In
Detroit, in the Opera House? Okay. And aside from Bugs Bunny, anyone ever see a real Valkyrie live in nature? Anybody? You ever seen one? Anybody? Given to understand our music director would like to have a full Bayreuth horn section, 8 horns, and that the 6 horns we've got here tonight are not quite sufficient. Do we have any extra horns wandering around that might be willing to... Yeah, 50 bits.
Hey!
Yeah, boy! Yeah, they're from Bayreuth. They just happen to be in the neighborhood.
Yeah, yes, that's good.
I guess what's good for the goose.
Thank you.
The distinguished musical career of Norman DeHoyo began for him at age 14 when he became a church organist and choir director of the Star of the Sea Church on City Island, New York. A descendant of Italian church organists, his father was an organist, pianist, singer, and vocal coach. DeHoyo recalls his father working with singers from the Metropolitan Opera arriving at their home in Rolls Royces. As a graduate student of Juilliard while he was an organist at St. Anne's Church in New York, he arrived at the conclusion that he just did not want to spend the rest of his life in the church choir loft as composition began to envelop all of his interest. By the late 40s, DeHoyo was considered one of America's leading composers and by the 50s had gained international recognition. He won the New York Music Critics Circle Award in 1948 and again in 1962. He won the Pulitzer Prize in 1957 for Meditations on Ecclesiastes for String Orchestra and an Emmy Award for his music in the television special scenes from the Louvre. In 1958, CBS featured him in a one-hour television special, Profile of a Composer. The Mary Duke Biddle Foundation commissioned DeHoyo's first wind band piece, Variations on a Medieval Tune. Written for the Duke University Wind Ensemble and Paul Bryan, its conductor, the work received its premiere performance on April 10, 1963. The medieval tune is In Dulce Jubilo, an early 14th century work attributed to Heinrich Suss, a German mystic who, according to legend, heard angels singing this tune and joined them in a dance of worship. DeHoyo's set of variations begins with a brief introduction, the theme, and then five variants contrasting in tempo and character. These metamorphoses utilize the sonic possibilities of the wind band to the highest degree. Please enjoy Variants on a Medieval Tune.
Thank you. Thank you.
version or the variations on the Baroque tune in Dulce Jubilo may have been barely recognizable at times through that last set of variations, but I'm quite confident that our next piece will sound exactly like the original, because it almost is the original, except it's been arranged for concert band as opposed to orchestra. This is a set of waltzes. Now, playing the full version, I remember sitting there once, and the directions were turned from page 13 back to page 7, then played to 19 back to page 2. I think our version is somewhat more truncated, and we only have 3 total pages, at least in the horn section. But this is a selection of some of the many waltzes from Johann Strauss Jr.'s collection of waltzes, the Blue Danube waltzes, or An der schönen blauen Donau. Annette Klein, music director?
Yes.
Thank you.
Jordan of his day. He composed nearly 40 major operas by the age of 37 and then retired at the peak of his career. He once remarked to a protege that the only way to write an overture for an opera was to wait until the night before the opening performance, then lock himself into a small room until the deed was done. Sounds like my theory. Nothing inspires more than necessity, he said. And the opera William Tell was actually very long. It was 6 hours long. Well, who is William Tell? William Tell was a legendary hero of Switzerland. His story, though not verified by history, represents the spirit of Swiss movement for independence from the Austrian Habsburgs in the 1300s. According to legend, Tell was a man of tremendous strength and the most skilled marksman in the whole state of Uri. The Austrian governor, Gessler, had ordered all Swiss to bow to a hat that he had set up on a pole in the main square of Altdorf. When Tell refused to bow, he was arrested, and Gessler knew of Tell's skill with the crossbow and promised to let him go free if Tell could shoot the apple off his own son's head. Tell hit the apple and then bitterly informed the governor that his son had been hurt. If his son had been hurt, he would have sent a second arrow into Gessler's heart. Gessler had seized him and chained him. While Tell was being taken across the lake in Gessler's boat, a storm broke loose, and Gessler ordered Tell untied to help steer the boat safely to shore. Escaping to shore, Tell shot an arrow through the tyrant's heart, and this act led to a revolt by the Swiss in which Tell played a leading role. The famous overture is a veritable tone poem beginning with the description of a Swiss dawn. A mountain storm gathers to the sounds of distant thunder, finally erupting in full fury. With its passing, the skies clear and raindrops fall from the branches. Birds sing their songs in the fresh air of the mountain meadow. And this pastoral scene is interrupted by the trumpet fanfare to a vigorous march. The finale, you will recognize, are fans, obviously, of the Lone Ranger, and this is where we most commonly would hear the William Tell overture.
Thank you.
We just happen to have brought one more Alphorn piece with us today. You heard the jazzy Alphorn swing last time. I hope you found it at least a little bit jazzy. Well, we've got a staple of the serious Alphorn concert repertoire for you next. But before we do that, I'd like to just trot out one more Alphorn parlor trick, and that is, we have a magician in our group who is actually able to play two notes at once on an Alphorn. True? Supersonic or subsonic note coming out of that. But that is a great feat that you don't find many Alphornists doing, even in Switzerland, and certainly not in the Recoil commercials. Anyhow, what we've got for you are two of the three movements from Gottfried Beit's Concertino for Alphorn and Band. And please, this is serious music, so just like William Tell is not about the Lone Ranger, the third movement of the Concertino is not about anything else.
Thank you.
As far as we know, we haven't done a lot of research, but we think we're the largest Alpern group in the country. And I think, and I'm not sure what our record number is, but we have had, I think, 16 Alperns together at one time. Which you can imagine is very good work for the plasterers, because the plaster in the houses tends to crumble. We're best off outdoors when that happens. John Griffith, who really sort of got our Alpern movement swinging in full tilt in Michigan, initiated a camp in Indiana and in Michigan, an Alpern retreat that we go to every summer for about 3 days. We have a professional French horn player who comes in and gives us basically Alpern lesson. She's someone who's very good with the Alpern. So it's it really is an instrument, and it pays off practicing like anything else, and we get together as often as we can, spread around the state of Michigan and Indiana. But we have a lot of fun with the Alperns, and hope you enjoyed our piece. We've got next for you a march. This is the Trittgefasst, or Step Lively March. Okay. Lawrence Welk was, of course, a very famous fellow, and he was best known for a particular kind of German sort of song, which is actually Polish, the polka. We've got a number of polkas for you coming up, but before we dig into them, we would just like to thank Annette and George Sennett and the rest of the North Oakland concert band for having the enthusiasm and openness to put this concert together. It was a ton of work, and Annette simply said, well, let's have fun. And so here we are today from across the state, around Michigan, and I pros the band based in Kalamazoo. Here we are in Lake Orion. So we're very happy to be here, and thanks to North Oakland Concert Band for the hospitality. So I'll bet you the Lawrence Welk fans aren't even familiar with one of the polkas in our next medley. This features just another polka in the hidden classic, the Hoop-Dee-Doo. Did a number of our arrangements, especially when we were first starting out as a German band. We had a number of Hammond organ arrangements that George definitely put into German band instrumentation. So thanks, George, wherever you are, for the great arrangement there. So, Earl Henry Mancini, the polka. So we have another polka for you next. You certainly would have heard this on Lawrence Welk, probably played by Henry Cuesta. We've done this in various different forms in the I Prosa band. We were at a band festival a few years ago and featured a tuba solo on this one, and she actually played solo that nobody could hear in the notes. But we do have, we've got our clarinet section featured today, and they've got some really nice low register playing too. Not quite as low as the subsonic tuba, but still wonderful stuff. This will be the I Prosa clarinet section featuring our guest clarinetist, Annette Klein. Yeah, sie heißt auch manchmal Heidi, aber bei uns ist sie Annette. And this is the clarinet muckle for the clarinet. Clarinet section feature,
yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Okay, we've got another polka for you by someone else from the Strauss family. This is, I believe, Josef Strauss, the father of Johann, who wrote, you know, collectively the family wrote somewhere into the thousands of very popular waltzes and polkas and other sorts of numbers. This particular one is called the Ohne Sorgen Polka. That's not to be confused with the Ohne Sorgen polka. Ohne Sorgen is carefree or without a worry polka, whereas the Ohne Sorgen polka would be the polka without socks. So hang on. So this is the carefree polka, and I think you'll enjoy it. We picked this up from a New Year's concert by the Vienna Philharmonic and thought it would be an interesting piece to add to our repertoire. So here we have the Ohne Sorgen polka.
Thank you.
Natural sound effects, but there are plenty of other Strauss pieces that feature all sorts of things, ranging from cannons to guns and everything in between. Our next piece is another polka. This is the Bergsteiger, or a mountain climber polka, featuring low brass, euphonium, and baritone solos. These guys are even worse if you feed them. So you can see the next piece in your program is the most famous Austrian song that no Austrian has ever heard of, because it was composed in America for Sound of Music. We've got Edelweiss for you next, and you'll notice the instrument is the Kuhglocken. Anybody got some idea of what that might be. Yep, it is, in fact, our mistress of Moo, Sandy Beck. You can see what a calming effect it exerts on the cattle. Anyhow, Sandy Beck will demonstrate the fine and noble art of the musical cowbells along with the strolling gypsy tuba player Lillian. You see, it apparently put the cows at ease, or to sleep, perhaps. So we had Sandy Beck on the musical cowbells, Larry Ellis, the bohemian strolling accordion tuba player, and our own Andrew's sister, Brett Christensen, on vocals. Well, we have a mitzingen for you next, or a zing-along. And we have a German song, Mein Vater war ein Bahnhofsmann. We've got the English lyrics for you in your program, but if you happen to know the German, you are more than welcome to sing along with us. Boys of the choir? Anybody else? I guarantee you don't want me up here alone. Come on, fellas.
All right.
Somebody needs to be between me and the microphone.
Thank you.
wondering if we had a tenor. It's nice to know there are tenor cows around if you need them. Feel free to join us.
Please join us and drown us out.
Yes.
About the cabin while we get the North Oakland Concert back on stage for a few combined numbers for you. And we're delighted to welcome back to the podium our own Heidi Annette Klein to conduct the combined ensemble in the Hofbräuhaus lead in München steht ein Hofbräuhaus. If you happen to know some of the filler words in between, feel free to sing along. Fräulein Klein?
Thank you.
second of our strangely beer-themed combined pieces. Well, I guess it's not that strange, is it? Started out as a Czech polka and migrated over to Germany where it became known as Rosamunde. And I believe it's still the best-selling sheet music in German-speaking countries. And somehow it turned into the Beer Barrel Polka in America. And you've probably heard accordion ensembles, kazoo ensembles, tuba ensembles, and maybe even an occasional German band. But here we are with Maestro Greg Andrews Christensen back to conduct the Beer Barrel Polka with romantic tuba players Amanda and Keith. Great show, huh? Makes you thirsty, though.